ago about that you should never do rewrite a project because normally it's a disaster, but this was an exception. So I want to tell you how it went and what I learned from that. And also I want to give you some advice about the political issues I faced. Okay, because I started, I came in this project as a newbie and essentially I had to rewrite everything. And it's not necessarily easy, even on political point of view, okay, because I will talk about that. So this work was done, this was at the Gemma Foundation, that probably you don't know about the Gemma Foundation, but is a non-profit foundation, and we do research about earthquakes. So essentially we are the guys that make that nice colored maps. Let me go back. That you see, no? Okay, this kind of maps. Oh, here it doesn't look too good because of the projector, but anyway, this is the map of Europe. This was a project called Share Project. Was done at the ETH Institute in Zurich, and essentially was the first project where the OpenQuake engine, which is the name of the product we do, was used to produce this this nice color, the map. And when it came at the GEM in nearly 4 years ago, 2012, this was already done. So we already had a successful software project which was able to produce this, which is a result of very big computation because there are 150,000 points and you compute essentially the hazard curves, so the probability you have in an earthquake and within a time period. And so I did not start the project. I mean, I arrived and I had to learn everything. And I had to change everything also. So now I want to give a bit of a presentation about me. So I'm a physicist because I come from academia too. And actually I did my fair bit of general relativity in the past. And also quantum field theory, the real stuff, okay? But then I switched a career, I found Python, I liked it. Maybe you read some of my papers. For instance, if you have studied multiple inheritance in Python, I wrote an article about the C3 method resolution order, and other series of papers on metaclasses with David Merz. And this was, 12 years ago when I started with Python. Then, because at the time I was still a physicist, and Python was my hobby, so I had the time to write papers, and then I started working. So my contributions to Python became a little bit less. I'm also the author of the decorator module that probably you are using if you don't know it, because it is a dependency of SciPy. I think it is also a dependency of IPython. It is a dependency of several web frameworks. I mean, pylons are the dependency. Even frameworks that I discovered one, I don't remember, there was a framework that were doing decorators in the same way I was doing it. So I looked in the source code and said, they had the same idea. And then in the source code, I found my code. There was a comment saying, taken from Michele Simionato decorator module. So probably you are using this code. It has under 1,000 downloads because it's using the framework. So I'm very happy with that module. Anyway, so I said, I started working as a Python developer. So the beginning with Zolpo Plon, which is an experience I don't recommend. And then worked for 7 years in finance. Okay, we were doing risk calculation of financial risk. And now I'm doing risk calculation, earthquake risk. Surprisingly enough, the terminology is very similar. We have the assets. Before, the assets were the options, stocks options. Now the assets are buildings. and you have to compute the damages. Something disastrous happens, and it's actually very similar. Also, we had an engine, calculational engine, and now we have an engine for the earthquake. So not so different at the end. And I arrived at GEM, as is written there, in October. And after a while, I became the man in charge of the OpenQuake engine, which is the simulation engine, the computational engine that really given the models, the seismic models that the scientists give us, we produce these maps. I'm doing this presentation because remember this morning Gael Varocco made this beautiful talk about the separation between the two worlds, the scientists one side and the web programmers and generally the programmers on the other side. And I made the transition and between those two worlds because I came from physics. I spent 10 years doing web development, database development, this kind of stuff. So I understand very well what he was talking about. It's true that it's a separation, and this separation between the worlds caused problems, because essentially in our case we had this scientific application, but the scientists didn't want to write this amount of code, especially because this has to run in a cluster, okay, concurrency, data storage, all kind of problems. So they hired some programmers, and they left the architecture, the decision to the architecture to the programmers. And they decided to do everything with the database, which was the source of all problems we had, okay, performance problems. Everything was impossible, essentially. And what I did in these 3 or 4 years was to drop the database, essentially, remove the database, as we will see. And I know very well the scientific world because I come from that, but also I know very well the business enterprise world. And I'm an old school boy, so I like not much the SQL, but the relational model. I like relational databases, okay? Spent several years working with SQL, with the query analyzer in Postgres, doing big stuff on databases, and I like the stuff. I'm very old style, I'm still using Max. And generally, I don't throw away old code just because it is old. This was my punchline. But sometimes we have to do that. So I'm going to talk about what happened and why I was forced to do essentially a total rewrite of the code, okay? Something which I never did, because I always worked with legacy code, but typically what you do, you rewrite small portion, you reformat, you clean up, you do small things. You don't throw away everything, okay? Because that would be foolish. But I was forced to do that, and we'll tell you why and what I learned. So this was my first reaction when exactly 4 years ago I got a job interview with this foundation, and I was discussing with the guys there, and they told me, we use Postgres to store our floating point numbers, essentially, big arrays. And I was very surprised. I said, well, never heard anybody doing serious numerical simulations with storing everything in Postgres. But I thought maybe the database is just, maybe they do the computation in memory, and then the database is just for storage, it's not really, maybe they have a good reason to use that. Indeed, on the contrary, there was no reason at all that they used Postgres, except that they were programmers, web programmers, so they knew Django. So everything was done as a web application. And there were really, really ugly stuff, like this, like a Django adapter to convert NumPy arrays in Pico object that then they were there stored in the database. Really ugly stuff. And since this was a kind of distributed calculation, you have these big arrays coming from the worker nodes. So you have a central node, the master node, where the database is here. You send this data through the... Actually, at the beginning, they were not sending the data. Actually, the workers were reading the database, doing the computation, sending back big arrays. Then all these arrays arrived at the same time, and there were locked in the database so that you could read from the database an array. Combine this with the array which were coming from the worker, doing some multiplication, things like that, and store again. And everything was locked, of course, because you have, I don't know, 500 workers, 500 by construction, they arrive more or less at the same time, so you are waiting. So, and then you have 100 workers who work writing on the same table. It was really a nightmare. And the worst thing was that there was no way to decouple the database logic with the scientific logic, because everything was in terms of Django models. Okay. Then what do you do in this situation? Rewrite everything. So I arrived, they said, here, the only way would be to remove everything. But what do you do? The code base actually was good in the sense, lots of tests, lots of doc strings, more or less well explained, etc. But the architecture was totally bad in the sense that it was impossible to get performance for that. And also, of course, I knew that if you need to rewrite something, it takes a lot more time than writing from scratch. Because if you start from scratch, it's easy. You have somebody who gives you the specifications. You know what you want to do. You don't have, you decide the technologies you want to use. You don't have many constraints. You start, you write. But when you have an existing code base, you must do reverse engineering. You must read what was there, try to understand why it was there. Then you ask for questions, and you ask, but why this, that? And they can tell you, no, I don't know, this was written by programmer X, which is not anymore here, because changed the job. Or this was required by this scientist, but now the scientist is in Peru. No, things like that. So it's a lot more complicated to rewrite than can write. So didn't want to do that. Why I say there is no choice? Because after a while, I did some experiments, I measured some things, and I discovered pretty early, actually in the first months I was there, that you had problems like the one you can see there. So essentially we were, in one of our calculators, we were producing ground motion fields. Ground motion field is the shaking of the earth, okay? There is an earthquake, and you say, this is the peak ground acceleration, for instance. You can compute these ground motion fields in all points. You have, I don't know, a grid of points or some points. You compute the ground motion fields, and the time to compute the ground motion fields could be this. But the time to save the ground motion fields could be a lot bigger. Actually, it was a lot bigger. So here the computation, I don't know, 4,000 seconds. And this is 40,000 seconds. This is an example I ran on my workstation. Actually, the situation in the cluster was much worse than that. So you have a situation where the computation takes 10 times less than saving the data in the database. And then and this was not the worst of it, because actually then you have to read this data from the database, and the real problem was reading the data from the database, because we ran out of memory. The first time we tried this computation, the cluster, we ran out of memory. The cluster was 128 gigabyte times four machines, so plus half a terabyte of memory. It was not enough. And then I later estimated that I would have taken more than 2 terabytes of memory to run that. So it was totally no way. Okay. So there were two options. Or you don't save the ground motion fields, or you save them in a more efficient way. And you can see here what seems... you may think there is an error here, because you see there is only one column, and the second column here is missing. Actually, it is not an error. So this is the release engine... okay, we have a number for the release of our software, the engine. This was release 1.5, and this was using the database, so it took I don't know, 40,000 cumulative seconds. Cumulative mean summing the time in all the workers. It took 40,000 seconds. Now with the release 2.0, it takes less than half second. Okay. So this actually is there, but you cannot see it because it is half second. So there are five order of magnitudes of difference, depending if you use the database, Postgres, or if you use HDF5. Okay. So five order of magnitudes. And actually, I must say that this is engine 1.5, but when I arrived, it was engine 1.0. It was before engine 1.0, and the situation was much worse because things I did was, for instance, to improve the Postgres queries, so I did a bulk insert instead of an insert many. I tried all things like remove the indices. I tried all the stuff that you can do in a database. So this is already very much optimized. Okay. But if you remove the database, you can gain five order magnitudes. And five order magnitudes means that 1 day of computation becomes 1 second. 1 year of computation becomes 5 minutes. So it means you can do a computation that otherwise was impossible to do. And I measured this kind of speedups. This not in the ground motion fields in another part of the code. And when I measured this speedup, I thought, no, I made a mistake. It's impossible. But then I measured again, and there was no mistake. So in this second case was there were thousands of queries because, okay, Django, there was using the object relational mapper, so instead of doing a big query, do lots of them. Anyway, these kind of measurements are real. And actually, there could be even bigger cases, but I couldn't measure because, you get tired after waiting 2 or 3 days, you get tired, you stop. But the larger the computation, actually, the larger the cluster, the worse the situation was. Also, if your database was mostly empty, okay, there is some performance. If the database is nearly full, so we had 1 terabyte of this space, then the performance is much worse, of course, because you have to insert inside the database which is already full. So, and we also had memory problems, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I didn't expect this kind of incredible results at the beginning because I knew about HDF5 because the scientist told me, actually. And I did some experiments, and I saw the HDF5 was at least 100 times faster. But I would not have expected 100,000 times. The reason is that when you do your small experiment, small dB is one thing. But in the large case, it is much worse, so the speedup is much better. So I wanted to remove this stuff, but you cannot sometimes. Because I went to my boss and said, look, there are these problems. And he told me, look, I believe you. I'm totally convinced that you are right, but the architecture of this application has just been rewritten. Okay? They spent 1 year rewritten. I cannot tell the scientists, oh, now we have to rewrite again. Okay? Because we have to release in 6 months. And actually, there's another interesting thing that a younger colleague of mine came a few months before me, did an analysis of the code, he told the same thing to the boss and sent an email. But this email, by mistake, went in the hand of the developers that wrote this architecture. And of course, they were not happy at all about that mail. So there was friction. And also the teams were split because we had half of the team in Zurich and half of the team in Pavia. I was in Pavia. And essentially, the team in Zurich did the hazard part. The hazard part means probability of having an earthquake. The risk part means economical damage. And we were in charge of the risk part. But it's very difficult to do an efficient calculation of the risk if the hazard comes to you in a format which is not a redirect one, okay? Because if you have to query tables that they are not structurally well for the risk. They maybe are structurally well for the hazard, but not for the risk, and the teams don't talk with each other, or there are issues, et cetera, that I don't want to go into, but you can imagine. So what I did nothing for 8 months, nothing except study, code base, learn what was there, maintain, fix the bugs, let the frustration grow, which I think is a positive thing, because the more you are frustrated, the more you want to change things. At a certain moment, if limited in time, at a certain moment you are motivated, at the end things can get done. So a bit of frustration is not so bad at the end. We had the test, we improved the section which were not the real problem, but you see, for instance, the first thing I did there was to put in place a monitoring system. So while the system was running, I could measure how much time it was taking to run queries, to do stuff. Okay? Even that was not so easy to okay. Maybe after the talk, if you want, ask me, I can tell you some story. And I wrote the XML parsing because the seismic models are in XML format. It was done badly. So the concurrency, I unified it using my MapReduce everywhere because it was done in strange ways. So anyway, there was a lot done in these 8 months, but not a real problem. But fortunately, the Zurich team evaporated, and I don't mean this in a bad way. Nobody was fired. Nobody was fired. But people left. It was made clear that the company wanted to move most of the development to Pavia and not to Zurich. So somebody left, found a better job. Somebody, also the contract with the DHH had a time limit. At the end of the limit, we said, okay, if you want, you can come to work with us, but in Pavia. And the guy said, I have a girlfriend here. So, you know, the team evaporated. And so we took charge, both of hazard and risk. And we started removing stuff. More than 10,000 lines of code. There was a lot of stuff which was really not used at all. Okay. We removed. And we decided what to do. Essentially me and my colleague, Luigi, the one that wrote the letter that I talked before. And we decide, okay, let's keep Postgres because we cannot throw everything away. And we changed a lot the database. So implemented the migration mechanism which was missing. So alter table, change the structure, change the queries. Lot of work. 13 months, more than 1 year spent fighting with Postgres. And we had something like one order of magnitude improvements, so we had a lot of improvements, but not five order of magnitudes, okay? But anyway, in the meanwhile, we had released, the release 1.0 went as scheduled, we had released, we had users, and by the way, I'm not saying that everything was broken, because some calculators, like the one I showed the map of Europe, that one didn't have big performance issues. So that one worked. It was the other one that had big problems. Anyway, we could maintain this software, this code working. Finally, at the end, this was in September, so nearly 2 years ago, these more measurements, and I realized that I could have improved a bit more on the Postgres side. But it was not worth the effort. I can say, okay, I can improve maybe a factor 2, 3, 5, but I need a factor of 10,000 to make this computation possible. So at the time, I knew that HDF5 was much better, so because we don't use print transactions, okay? The architecture was wrong because we didn't need the database at all. We didn't need to do any queries. We had some geospatial queries which were extremely slow. We didn't need to do these queries. Okay. So it was totally useless, that advice. So I decided, let's try to remove that. And with the excuse of the Windows porting, because we wanted to make, because we are doing open source software, the software called OpenQuake Engine. Open, so it means everything is in GitHub. You code reviews, everything is public. And we want this software to run on any platform. So the idea that any scientist in the world, seismologist, can download this and run on his laptop, not only on a cluster. So if you want to run also on a Windows cluster, a laptop, maybe you don't want to have a scientist to install Postgres and fight with the configuration files, things like that. So we didn't want a Postgres for that. So I said, let's try to write a light version. Okay, so we keep the monster as it is, but we write a small version that doesn't depend on the database. I say excuse because for me it was clear from the beginning that at some moment the toy model, the light version, would have been replaced completely the old monster. That was the my pilot plan from the beginning. So anyway, I did that. It was a lot of effort because I needed to duplicate essentially old calculators, new calculator, make sure that they give the same numbers, run the same test. Fortunately, we have a lot of functional tests. But I learned stuff, which is the file. I made a lot of changes. So here are some of them. So now I plan to leave time for questions. So I will just leave you read these slides. And then if you have questions on these points, please ask me in 10 minutes, 5 minutes when I finish. So there were a lot of changes. And but the end of the story is that there is no Postgres anymore now. There is a SQLite database. The SQLite database is used to store metadata information. For instance, I have a calculation, there is a job ID, start time, stop time, description, then there is a table with the logs of that calculation, there is a table with the output of the calculation, and a table with the performance of the calculation. And that's it. All the scientific data, all the arrays are inside the HDF5 that if you don't know what HDF5 is, please study it because it's really impressive software, extremely easy to use, and extremely performant. Okay, these are some of the things I did. Again, ask me after if you're interested in this type, this kind of stuff. And a lot of stuff. I did the port in Python 3, the port into Windows, serialization to HDF5, lots of work on XML, because at the beginning we had the XML schema, which was not another completely wrong idea. Anyway, lot of stuff. And I'm surprised because at the end it seems to be working, but still surprised because with such an enormous change, it went surprisingly well. Eh? I don't know. Anyway, it went well in the sense that, wow, we actually have a performance which is really thousands of times better than before. We have more tests than before. The scientists are happy. They can run it on their laptop. It works on Windows. It works on Mac OS. Works on Linux. Works everywhere. Even on the Raspberry Pi, we tried. Works. And worse. So I learned some. I want to tell something about what I learned that may be interesting for you. This is I already knew, but you see, after this work, I believe in these things even more. So it is really essential: the monitoring the system is the first thing we should do. And also, we had the problem with the unit test, with the test, because there was a database. So in the test, you had to create fake tables, populate rows, delete rows, do all this kind of stuff. And the test took, 2 hours to run. And now they run in seconds, because if you have an HDF5, it's really easy. Also, most of these unit tests I removed, the original one, because they were testing details on the implementation, and if I changed the implementation, I was forced to change the test. And I tried to replace them with functional tests. Functional tests instead are what really the scientist wants, because the scientist tell me, look, with this model, you should get this result, and he gave me a CSV file of numbers, and I compare the numbers. That's what the scientist wants. They don't want to test the implementation details. And okay, I learned this kind of stuff. So also, I am old enough now, so I am some white hair, so I feel that I can give some technical advice to people. And my technical advice is, first, do things simple. don't care too much about performance. Two things, simple. When they are simple, 95% of the time are already faster without doing anything, just removing craft, okay? And also, don't spend time in complicating your technological stack, because I got requests from people telling me, why don't you try to use numbers? Why don't you try to use graphical processing unit? Why don't you try to compile with the intercompiler, which are all good things, But, you know, my problem was the database. First, I have to remove the database. Then I can think to this thing. I cannot complicate the stuff. I first simplify. And also, always change the assumptions. For instance, we have these very complex geospatial queries. So we were using PostGIS. And at the end, you say, but do we really need these geospatial queries? And the answer was no, we didn't need. So I removed totally the geospatial queries, and everything was better than before. So challenge the assumptions. Just because some code is there, maybe should not have been there. Okay. And so my advice is take the most difficult problem that you can solve. This is in italic. Okay. So it means if you cannot solve the problem, wait a bit. Have a plan B. Have also plan C, D, E, F, because, of course, the big problem is not easy. But keep in mind what the big problem is, and everything that you do is with the goal of solving the big problem. In this case, was removing Postgres, the big problem, okay? So I couldn't remove Postgres for 8 months for political issues, but I kept thinking about it. And be patient. Also some political advice. Yeah, with the boss. You know, when you are a newbie and you come, you say, I would like to change everything, and the boss, correctly, I think, will tell you, wait a bit. And he's right, so it's not a problem. Take the slow way. And every time you do a small change, make sure that the scientists, the users, get a measurable advantage. So you can tell, oh, I did change this change, and now this is 50% faster. And the user will be happy. So the next time you propose, I would like this change, they will believe you because they knew from experience that what you did before was okay. So they will believe you. So it takes time to build trust because when you arrive, even if you are, I mean, like me, over 40, well-experienced programmer, when you are a new place, you are a newbie. So you need to take your time. Doesn't mean that you must say yes always. You shouldn't be a yes man, okay? You can raise your voice. Sometimes there are technical issues that you can discuss and reach an agreement. Sometimes you don't reach an agreement because simply, you see, they're not technical. There are, for instance, one thing, I want a single repository and not three repositories. And for me, was a big issue for the boss. Said, no, but we had a single repository. It was split in three. Now we want to merge them together. So understand. By the end, now we have a compromise. So from four repositories, now we have only two. So not a single, but see, sometimes you can fight a bit. And I discovered several things that essentially here did some experiment retrieving from the database floating point numbers. So a floating point number for 32 bits, 4 bytes. Using PsychoPG took something like, 30 bytes. Because you know that the Python float is already 24 bytes. Plus add the layer of PsychoPG, more bytes. Add Django, more bytes. So 4 bytes can become 50 bytes. So it can be an order of magnitude. So this was surprising that the effect was so big. Also other experience they had that sometimes you make a design because you don't want to run out of memory. So, and you do that. It doesn't run out of memory, but maybe it takes 1 week. So your computation runs for 1 week. You don't get any feedback. And maybe at the end, finally, you run out of memory or even you don't run out of memory, but never ends. And the scientist comes and says, but why this is stopped? So it is best, actually, to let it fail. Okay, it runs out of memory after half an hour. The scientist knows, oh, what happened? Run out of memory after half an hour. Maybe you put a wrong parameter. So they know after and half an hour that they put a wrong parameter, that was the reason. Or, okay, so sometimes it's better to have a design actually where you use more memory And maybe it fails, but it fails early, and then you can take action and decide what to change. Also, it is more efficient if you try to do everything in memory. Yeah, there are the other story that I can tell. But. Oh, these are, yes, 7 minutes, let's say 2 minutes, okay, 2 minutes I will finish. What I did for the concurrency, I decided I liked the concurrent futures. So I changed every, because we had some reinvented the concurrency in this strange way. So we had at least 3 ways of doing concurrency. So I remove all and I say, let's use concurrent futures. And use the interface of concurrent futures and then write a mapper reduce on top of that. And I have a pluggable system. So if I am on a laptop, I use concurrent futures with multiprocessing, essentially. If I am on a cluster, we use Celery. Everything was tested. The Python 3 part was tested in Travis, whereas for the Python 2, we were using Jenkins. And it's good. Wheels are really, really great because we have this problem that you saw at the keynote this morning. These wheels, especially the many Linux wheels, which are very recent, 6 months ago, with those you can distribute your code essentially in all platforms without problem. H5PY has some bugs, strange behaviors, can give you a segmentation fault. So I recommend it, but pay attention. I have some regrets too, because essentially for 2 years we spent time trying to optimize Postgres, which was a battle against windmills. There was no hope to win that battle. I should have removed more stuff, especially the tests, because, you know, I am old, so I'm conservative. If I see some tests, I think these tests are important. So if they break, I fix them. If they break again, I fix them. If they break again and again, I fix for the 3 times. After 4 times that I see that these tests are actually in my way, and I don't need those, and it's better to throw them away and replace them with something else. After 4 times, I do that. I should probably, if I had if I did it the first time, I would have spent, okay, it was a regret. Okay, and also spend sometimes time to port features that after discussing with the scientists, I discovered they were not even intended features. So the scientists said, but the engine is doing that. I didn't know about it. So, and they were features well tested, etc. So I expected to be very important. They were not. So these are regrets. Still, I'm very proud of this slide. Very, very proud of this slide. Because our code base is split, as I said, in two. One part is the Hazardlib, which is the, let's say, the low-level libraries, which is still in Python, but it's low-level. It's the part that the scientists work on. And unfortunately, I don't see here the... But there are numbers here. You don't see the epsilons, but anyway. This is the release of the engine, and the number of lines of code, this is something like for 30,000 to 70,000 line of codes. So in 3 years, because this is 3 years, from release 1.0 to release 2.0, 3 years, we more than doubled the number of lines of code, and it's fine because the scientists added more models, more seismic models. But if you look at the size of the engine, which is my part, let's say, I reduced the size from 55,000 to, I don't know, 45. So I was able to, after 3 years of working there is now less code than before, and I'm very proud of that. You know that in the intermediate release, there were duplication, lots of ugly stuff, so there was more code. But finally, I removed all the stuff, and now there is no more the old engines. 95% of now the code has been rewritten. And so, let's say that I'm happy, even if it took nearly 2 years instead of 1 year that they fought, but...
Thank you.